I'm your host, Micah Versman, and this is the Producer Podcast. Today, we are continuing our department head series as we talk with DP Dan Parsons about what a producer should know about the camera department. So without further ado, let's get started. To start, maybe in case people aren't familiar with you, take a few minutes and just kind of introduce yourself.
So I've been working as a DP for just a month shy of like 20 years. The beginning of my career is very interesting in that I started composing music for film and television and CD-ROM, if anyone remembers what a CD-ROM is. my undergrad degree was in K-12 music teaching. So I was trained as an educator, and I got into music composition. That was part of my major. And so music really was what I thought I was going to do with my life. And I started writing scores for different types of media, and ended up in 1998, I started writing the score for a feature film. And it was just, I lived in Austin, Texas at the time. The film was shot on 35mm. And I didn't know anything about the film industry. And so I started scoring this film, and I started going downtown Austin to this editing suite. And there's these two brothers there, Mark and Jay Duplass. I had no idea who these guys were. And this is kind of in the big Robert Rodriguez time frame when, you know, Mariachi had come out. And there's this like just big indie revolution happening. And here I am right in the middle of Austin, Texas, where it's kind of going on, in one of the big cities where it's going on. So years later, to look back at that experience and realize I'm sitting in with these two indie darlings who are doing all this work. I'm looking at an Avid 1.0. Like, I don't even know what I'm looking at, you know, but I've got this box, hours and hours of VHS dailies that I'm writing music to. And between that box of dailies and sitting behind the shoulders of Mark and Jay Duplass in their studio and watching them cut and seeing that process really became for me my film school. And that process, though, of writing music for the movie, I loved writing music and I loved movies, but the process of writing music for a movie didn't end up really appealing to me, because at the time, you know, 20 years ago, music sampling wasn't what it is now. I could not get incredible samples of strings and brass instruments and things like that. And I'm a classically trained composer, and I'm wanting to do these orchestral pieces along with the electronica that was needed for the film. But I realized nobody around here is going to have a budget for hiring an orchestra and recording an orchestra. And so I just reasoned at that time, I'm going to be miserable in this career because I have, you know, champagne tastes and there's not even a beer budget. You know, it was like, that's a horrible analogy to use right now, isn't it? No. But the reality is I realized early enough on that I was just going to drive myself crazy because I wanted to produce something that at that time wasn't really technically possible and financially possible for a lot of productions. But in the process, I got bit by the camera bug. Right around that time, I ended up getting hired at IBM. I became a multimedia producer there. And then flash forward another year and a half, 9/11 happened. And essentially, there was a massive downturn in the economy and really hit the tech market. And so one day, I was let go from IBM along with several hundred other employees. And so here I am thinking, I just lost the safe job, so why don't I take a huge risk and do something that I really want to do and get the dangerous job, you know, the job that doesn't have a lot of security. And so they gave me a decent severance package, and I was able to use some of that to go to film school. So I went off to the New York Film Academy and attended their 8-week film production course. And while I was there, somebody from Austin called me and said, "Hey, I heard you went to film school. When you get back, will you shoot my movie?" And I'm thinking to myself, film school? This is just kind of like an 8-week crash course. But crazy me, I just said, sure. And long story short, like this is no exaggeration, I came back, I shot that project. While I was on that project, somebody asked me to shoot their film. And a year later, I was getting paid to do that, to shoot people's movies. And the interesting process for me was that I never really worked my way up. People just started asking me to shoot their film. They're like, well, you can DP this. Well, I didn't even know really when I went to film school what a DP was. Truly, I'd heard of the word cinematographer, but I didn't know what that meant. And I ended up working for 3 solid years before I finally acknowledged I'm already doing what I want to do. I was getting paid to do it. And so I have a very strange career that I was probably the world's most reluctant DP who fell into it and realized it was more than just my initials. It really was what I was made to do. It fits so many of the skills and abilities as well as the passion. And so that's kind of the long version of how I got to where I am. And honestly, it was 3 to 5 years before I really embraced that I was already doing what I was happy to do for the rest of my life. So here I am.
That's really cool. Yeah, it's been fun hearing people's stories on how they got started, and yours very, very different and unique, but sounds like it was a fun journey.
It really was, and I was very blessed to have a lot of people who took risks with me. I mean, you know, they some of them didn't even ask a question, like, had you ever shot a film before? I guess they'd seen my work or something. I didn't know even how it worked, but one thing became very clear to me very early on is that lighting was an aspect of what I do that just made sense to me. It was just like a very natural part of what I did. I didn't even think about it for whatever reason. And when people started telling me how difficult it was to light, I kind of had moments where I was like, am I doing something wrong? Like and it's not that it's just easy, but it just, lighting is just a thing that just makes sense to me. I don't know how else to say it. And that became one of the hiring points for me. People would see something that I shot and it was lighting that drew them to my work and stuff like that. So, and it's interesting because I would always approach that from a standpoint of, I'm not here to necessarily make something look beautiful. I'm here to light something to be appropriate to the story. Everything I did was very story driven. And so on one project, it may be to make something look very glamorous and very accessible in that way. And in another instance, it would be to make something look gritty or dark and contrasty. And so I was never, for whatever reason, I never limited myself to any particular style or look. And years later, what I've come to figure out is I don't really have a style. And I love that because what drives me is that I have an approach, and my approach is very story centric. My approach is very much, what are the needs of the production? How do we need to achieve this? And as we think about, probably as we begin to get into this conversation about producing, you're going to see very quickly how I am very much thinking about producing while I'm working as a DP, because I'm always honest with myself about what is available to me in terms of resources, whether that's financial, whether that's a human resource, whether it's lighting. You know, there's so many aspects. And you know, as an artist, technician, and manager, which my mentor used to say that we have 3 roles as a DP. We're an artist, technician, and a manager, and in that order. I bring to bear those 3 things as I approach every film that I do.
Okay. I like that. So jumping in then to kind of the pre-production area, at what point in that pre-production should the producer start trying to get a DP locked onto the project?
I think a DP, once a director is chosen, I think the most natural progression is as soon as possible a DP should be brought onto a project. And I would also include a production designer. And a lot of people, it's a little known fact that a DP and a production designer are on the same plane, so to speak. They're on the same level in a production. And it's a very, it should be a very cohesive relationship. It should be, everyone's making the same movie here. And so I have been on quite a number of films where that's not really understood. And so I think sometimes I can really show up. But very early on, a director should be empowered to bring on, you know, and work with, begin to work with the cinematographer and production designer of their choosing, that's right for the story. And so there are so many decisions that are going to be made in those first few days and weeks. As one person has said it before, fix it in planning, you know. And there are so many decisions mm-hmm. that can be fixed in the planning stage that don't precipitate these very expensive downstream costs for a film.
You as a DP then, when a producer calls you up about coming onto a project, what information do you like that producer to be able to give you in that first conversation?
I want to understand from the producer's point of view, because the producer's point of view is very different from a director's point of view. While there are parallels, by nature of the position, by nature of what aspect each individual and each role in a film is doing, they have a unique perspective to offer. But first and foremost for me is I want to understand what is the story truly, you know. And a lot of times we get into conversations about plot, but as my mentor would always say, is don't get so caught up shooting the plot that you miss what's really going on in a film. So it helps me to understand from a producer's standpoint what the story is. And in that conversation, listening to them tell that story, I'm gonna really store that in my memory. And then as the director then tells me from their perspective what the story is, like I'll start to build out and triangulate a true view of what it is that we're making. Because one of the most important things to me is that in the endeavor of making a film, it's important to me that everybody's making the same film. And so for me to understand from the person hiring me, from the producing level, what story it is that they intend to make, and then to triangulate that with the vision that the director has of how we want to make that, it really helps me to hit the target. Because one of the most important things that I want to do as a cinematographer is not hit the target, but hit their target. So hit the mm-hmm. target of the producer and the director as they're achieving this. That's super important to me because I know what I'm capable of, but that's kind of besides the point. I want to be challenged and have the opportunity to do something beyond what I knew I was capable of. And then that for me is making sure I'm hitting their mark.
Okay. I've never heard a DP approach it like that, at least from like the producer's standpoint of how they view the story. But it makes a lot of sense.
Well, if you think about it, so my role as a cinematographer is a service role. You know, I am going to be your first audience member. And that's something that you'll hear me say very often on set. If something's going wrong or if something just didn't click right, and it's for me, it's about resonating with truth. I will very often you'll hear me say something as your first audience member. This is what I just experienced. And the reason why I'll do that is the director may have been seeing something, but I will read and fully understand not only the story and the screenplay, but I'll also do character studies. And that surprises a lot of actors when they hear me start talking about character on set. It's because I care very deeply. My lighting is motivated by character. My camera work is motivated by character and story. And so you've heard the phrase, the joke, like, I do not think that word means what you think it means. And yeah. As a DP, what I will often say is, what were you intending? And if I didn't experience what was just shared back with me in terms of the intention behind a shot, I'll say, I don't think this picture is saying what you think it's saying. And so those conversations are very helpful. And I will always have a reason, like, here's what was happening here. And so I'm always looking to understand fully what's supposed to happen in a moment, and then also within the story itself. And I think it can be very refreshing for producers and directors because they realize I'm really out to make sure that everything serves that original conversation of this is the story we're setting out to tell, and this is the person I've hired to tell it in this very specific way. And so that helps us stay on track.
So during that pre-production process, how can a producer help you as the DP when it comes to building out your camera department?
So we've talked a little bit about the story and the artistic side of things. Now I want to know technically and financially what are our obligations, what are our resources, and what are our goals. So one of the biggest initial questions is going to be, what is our medium of highest impact? So what that simply means is where will this production live and see the highest audience? What will be the highest number of views on what platform and what format and what presentation? And so if a movie is going theatrical, questions start to lend themselves to a certain direction. If it's going to be YouTube or online, it's going to be another thing. If it's specific to, we feel that the largest number of viewers are going to be viewing this production on a cell phone, then that's going to be an entirely different set of questions and answers. And so for me to first and foremost find out what's the medium of highest impact, and then what will some secondary mediums be, that begins to help me build an intelligent response to what camera should we use? What kind of lighting should we use? What lens package should we go with? Because I'm a cinematographer who very much believes in everything serving the story. Mm-hmm. And part of that being, you know, if you're shooting a production where you need an incredibly high number of setups during a 12-hour period or a 10-hour period, whatever your day is, and that might also involve moving the camera between a dolly and a tripod and handheld and some kind of stabilization, whether it's Steadicam or gimbal or whatnot, that's a lot of setup. And so I want to intelligently answer those questions in a way that makes sure if we have to hit this number of setups in a day's time, we're not going to shoot on an IMAX camera probably. Now, I kind of jumped to an extreme there, but you understand what I'm saying immediately when I do that. And a really amazing cinematographer once told me, the master never complains about the tools. And what he meant by that is, you know, whether I'm shooting with an inferior piece of equipment, whether it's a tripod, or whether I'm shooting with older lenses, or whether I'm shooting with a sensor that is inferior to another sensor I'd love to be shooting with, that's not the question. The question is, how can I exploit both the strengths and the weaknesses of that particular equipment? And while I may not be, an IMAX camera with a great film stock and the best post-production processing can yield a beautiful image, if I need to get 24 or 30 setups in a day's time, and I don't have the crew to do it, because the budget didn't allow for that, and we don't have all the right pieces in place, it doesn't matter how beautiful that image mm-hmm. is going to be. I'm not going to, at the end of the day, achieve the results that we need. And so I'm always answering the question of what is the best way to approach each film. And as we answer those questions and we understand all the technical things behind actually acquiring the images that will be made into the film, that's the way to do it. And that's why I tend to think of myself as being very camera agnostic, very lens agnostic, because I'm always looking for the best imaging system for the film.
One of the things I've heard a number of DPs talking about is a lot of their problems could have been solved if they had had time to have camera prep days and camera test days before shooting started. So I was wondering if you could maybe take a little bit of time to talk about why that's important and how that can benefit the production.
Right. It's crucial. So imagine, let's say you have 10 crew members. Just say you're in a relatively small situation. You've got 10 crew members and you've not done a camera prep day. And you're taking forever to simply build the camera or de-rig the camera and build it on another transport device, whether it's a dolly or a jib or just handheld even sometimes. You know, depending on the rigs that you're working with, a lot of times you're breaking that camera system down quite a bit just to get it on the other transport apparatus. And again, that transport apparatus might be something as simple as handheld. And those ideas, those processes are sometimes discounted greatly. But I'm going to make this make sense very monetarily quickly. Imagine that process going wrong or taking a long time while you are paying by the hour or by the day 10 people versus you are paying only one or two people by the hour or by the day. I don't think I have to explain that math to anyone. So it is better to spend a small amount of money that is money well spent by giving one or two prep days of quickly understanding how you want to build and break down that camera as you move between systems or between transport apparatus. You're really only paying for those two people. And you're also not, you know, every director will appreciate this when I say this, and every actor will appreciate this. There is a momentum that occurs on a film set that's either good or it's bad. And when an actor and a director really get into the zone and they're really capturing some great material, the ability to quickly go to a new setup, the ability to quickly turn around, the ability to maintain that emotional and that technical momentum that is established is huge. And I think something that sets me apart as a cinematographer is I'm extremely aware of that performance and that acquisitional momentum that is on a set, because I want to be able to do those turnarounds as fast as possible, because as I get further and further into my career, the most important thing to me is performance. Because it doesn't matter how much money you put in front of the lens in production design or location or how much the lens costs that I'm capturing it with. If those performances aren't there, I don't have a thing. So this is a huge reason why I want to basically assume all of the technical. And so back to the heart of your question, assuming the technical means I've had a day in prep or 2 days in prep for my camera assistants to build and break down the camera to all the different ways that camera is going to be used on set so that they're familiar with it. They have a memorization down of what needs to happen there, because all of that is going to serve not only us making our day, that's only part of making your day is one thing, but did you make your day in such a way that you had those moments to capture that performance because you had another take, because you had an extra setup, or what? Those things are what's really important. Those prep days are money well spent. I mean, you can't even put a price on that.
So once you get to then the actual production phase, how can a producer be of help to you in the camera department?
If I could, real quick, let me jump backwards to begin to help answer that question, because we were talking about planning. Ideally, going into that production, you will have created a strip board, so we'll understand our day of days for not only the actors. But one of the important things that could happen is you could create a day out of days for the equipment, right? Okay. And so if I don't need a Steadicam for the entire shoot, let's not pay for a Steadicam for the entire shoot. Let's do our best, you know, with the AD and the production team to figure out how it is to best organize our days to maximize our budget. It doesn't do me any good to have a Steadicam sitting on a truck somewhere. It doesn't make me feel any more confident or hopeful about the shoot. It just means we're paying somebody money to have their equipment on our vehicle. But what does help us is to understand that if I have carefully worked with production to figure out the best use of our resources, then jumping back into this question, I can with confidence go to that producer. And if that producer and that UPM understand that going into this production, I have done due diligence on the expenditure of money, they're going to have a trust relationship built up that when I ask for something, I'm not asking for something for me. I'm asking for something, not even just for the film, but for the story. There's a story reason always. There's a performance reason always. And that's what I do. So part of that jumping back real quick is, in the beginning of production and the planning, I'm going to ask two questions. I'm going to ask, what's our most important scene in the film? And what is our most challenging scene to film? And I don't necessarily assume that the answer to those questions is the same. But when it's not the same, I want to understand if the most important scene is not the most difficult scene, why are we shooting the most difficult scene? Not saying we shouldn't, but let's all be honest, the reason we're shooting the most difficult scene is what? It fulfills what? Does it add production to value? Does it add contrast or affinity with what we're trying to do? But there has to be a really good reason we're spending this much resource on the most challenging scene if it's not the most important scene to the film. Because the beauty of a professional editor is they don't care how much you spend on a scene or a shot. You know, mm-hmm. they are going to cut based on story, based on performance. And so, you know, they're not even going to want... If I was a producer, I wouldn't want my editor on set. I wouldn't want them to know I spent $1.5 million on that one shot. I don't want them to care. I want them to kill that baby seal if they have to. Get their club out and beat it to death. Right? And I have to speak in that violent of terms because that's sometimes to a producer or director what that must feel like. Is, wow, you're killing my baby. Right? And so the beauty is we remain emotionally removed from the decision. So in the planning, again, what's the most important scene? What's the most challenging scene? And if they're not the same, why are we shooting the most difficult scene? And when they are the same, it's lovely because you realize we're going to spend more resource right here. And it's okay. Yeah. And we're going to build our days around that. We're going to build our weeks around that. We're going to build our budget around that. And every producer should be thinking on those terms. Every director, every cinematographer, everybody involved should be on the same page of this is what this is why it's important, and this is how, as a result, we're going to do it. So now we're jumping forward back into your question of then how do you talk to the producer? Honestly, it becomes an extension of our pre-production talks. We've already set the stage of, am I saying there's no surprises that show up? Of course there's surprises that happen on set, but in general we're just sort of adding to the conversation that's already taken place in pre-production. So by the time it's important for me to come to a producer and say, you know, we really ought to have a drone on this, we really ought to have a Steadicam on this or a gimbal, you know, there is a background to that reason, but there's also mm-hmm. an established trust that knows, hey, when Dan's coming to me, he's not going to just ask me for something. There's a really good reason why he's asking for it, and it has nothing to do with his reel.
Okay. Yeah. No, that I really like that, and I'm already going back through my head comparing most important and most difficult scenes and films I've been a part of to see how they match up.
I'd love to follow up with, I'd love to sit in a room with producers and just chew on that question for half a day. Like,
yeah.
Like how many times did they line up? How many times did they didn't? And how many times did that cost the production its costliest blunders?
Mm-hmm.
Or most serendipitous, beautiful occasions?
Yeah. So then, almost on the reverse side of that question, are there things you've seen producers do on set that haven't been helpful?
I had a producer say to me, I traveled overseas and I was about to shoot 14 commercials for a very well-known company. And we were having a conversation and there was big questions in terms of the camera to be used. And this producer was dead set. We were going to use, this was back in the days, the early days of the Red. And
okay.
Remember, put the asterisk here, is that Dan Parsons likes to remain format agnostic, imaging system agnostic. Like it is my duty to be an expert on whatever I'm using, but it's my integrity and ethics to make sure that I'm at least recommending the best system for the job. So we spent, this is almost unreal to say out loud, but we spent 14 days in a row with no day off going to each of the 14 places where we were going to be filming the commercials. And I knew that the decision to shoot on the Red was fairly well set in stone. and it wasn't a decision that I had made. It was the red was new, and it was like the popular thing to do. There was a lot of marketing behind making a decision like that. There was a lot of PR and stuff like, hey, we shot this on the red. Well, I had actually shot on the red prior to this. It was a very early build of the red one, and people were saying it was like a 400 or 500 speed camera. But in all of my shooting, I was comfortable rating that camera for a 200 or 250 speed camera. So I realize I'm talking to a bunch of people who aren't cinematographers, most likely. And so what in the world does that mean? What that simply means is it takes a lot of light to make a good image on that camera. Otherwise, your image is either going to be really dark or it's going to be really noisy because you're cranking your ISO in order to build a usable image. But then at the end, you really question whether it's usable because it's got a ton of noise in it, depending on your sensor. Mm-hmm. So the bottom line was the producers came to me saying, we've got to make this camera system work. At the end of the day, I had taken my camera around and took pictures at that ISO that I knew would actually work. So I'm taking all these pictures that on purpose do not look very good. They're dark. And it's because I need to be able to show the producers that if we choose this camera system, this is in fact what your images are going to look like. Are you okay with that? Because if you're telling me this is what I have to shoot with, I will do it. But I will not refuse to advise you. I'm going to show you this is exactly what you... Here's a little quote. Here's a little soundbite for you. Just tuck this away and remember this. As filmmakers, as producers, as directors, whoever it is, surround yourself with people who are not afraid to tell you what you don't want to hear. And be okay with it. Because we must be confident. We must understand that if we don't trust the people that we bring on to make the to be in the trenches with us when we're in the process of doing this, what do you have? So mm-hmm. I was able to show them not only what it would look like, but I had done my homework to understand, because I was hopefully what was going to happen. I predicted what would happen was that they're going to say, well, then what should we shoot on? And I already had an answer. What was crazy is the camera system I introduced to them wasn't even available in the country. Nobody in the country had even shot with that camera system before. And so it was literally starting from scratch. So I recommend it, at that point in history, it was the Silicone Imaging 2K, SI2K camera. It was this tiny little box of a camera. It was kind of a 16, super 16 focal length with a crop factor. And so we had to get three of those bodies from the UK to do these commercials. But it was a more sound choice based on its exposure and dynamic range. But there's the answer to that is when a producer is making a decision for the cinematographer without giving the cinematographer a chance to weigh in artistically, technically, with the goals. See, we go back to that goals question. You know, that's why I start with what are your goals for this? What are we how are we trying to deliver this? Those conversations drive every downstream question after that. So now we're into, well, what camera should we use? So trust. Producers must learn to understand why they're trusting somebody. And you know what's interesting is I tell people all the time, you need to assume cinematography, like the technical aspects of that. You need to assume that somebody understands how to light something, that somebody knows how to operate a camera, that somebody has mastered that format, that somebody has understood why there's... like. Unfortunately, you can't do that, but you should assume that. What comes next is what you really want to hire a person for is them leveraging all of that, all of those tools in the toolbox, and building that trust with you to take your story further than you thought possible because of what they bring to the party. You should hire a cinematographer because of what they bring to the party, not because they can do what everybody else can do.
Yeah.
You should hire them because of what only they are uniquely capable of doing.
That's good. Jumping now to post-production. I've heard a lot of DPs talk about how they don't like not being involved at all in post-production? What areas of post-production you wouldn't recommend keeping a DP involved with, and why that's good for the project?
I say, why would you not want your DP through the image pipeline? Because you should know, unfortunately, with the digital revolution, it has really democratized the process. And what that means is there once was a time where nobody saw the image, not even the cinematographer, until it went through the lab and came back. And even then, it was a very milky print of the negative. It wasn't even a strongly contrasty or saturated image, because it was it was based off that negative. Those were your rushes, your dailies. But there was this mystery to the image that really only the cinematographer understood. The cinematographer understood what that image was going to look like, even though what you were looking at the time looked nothing like it. And unfortunately, nothing has changed. That is still the case. But the problem is, when we're able to run a LUT to a monitor and we're running video that looks, we have the very expensive viewing equipment on set, we are able to get to a very finished look on set. And so that can denigrate into everyone feeling like they're a cinematographer. But what they don't realize is, and this happened on that same project where I was shooting on that SI2K camera, they did exactly this. They decided they wanted to save money in post, so they sent me home 2 weeks early. So as soon as we were done with production, they sent me home. And strange scenario, I ended up being in another country 3 months later, like only 600 miles away, but I'm sitting in this cafe in Israel on my computer one time in the middle of a production, but I was like at lunch or whatever, and my Skype comes up on my computer, and it's the post house, and they're going, "Hey, can we talk to you about this image?" And I was like, sure. And they said, "So we're having a problem with these commercials." And I said, "Can I stop you there? You may not be having a problem." They were talking about the image, and I said, "Let me guess. Is it really washed out? Is there no contrast and is there no saturation?" And they were very excited. They're like, wait, how'd you know that? Like, did you see it or something? And I was like, no, that's exactly what it's supposed to look like right now. And this was before lookup tables, LUTs were common knowledge. Everybody can go anywhere and look up a LUT now. But this camera was so early in that process that people didn't understand how to convert a very logarithmic look it looks just like a milky image into a usable final image. But nobody in the post house knew how to work with that. And they didn't even understand they needed that. And I said, "Well, I'm happy to help you, but, I was cut out of the process." So I kind of gave them some tips and some things. But how they got to the final image, I don't even know their process and what kind of lengths they went to. So it's never wise to take the person who acquired the images from the beginning, to take them out of the process, because they are going to be the ones to understand. Here's a for instance. There are moments on set when I choose specifically to underexpose a scene because I understand the limitations of that particular camera. And I know that if I underexpose that one scene, I will be able to lift the shadows in post to the right amount to bring that scene back, but I'll never be able to recover the highlights if I overexpose them. And so I understand those moments when I want to underexpose a scene. I also understand those moments when I want to overexpose a scene because I won't be able to recover the shadows. And if a person is, if a film is not going through a colorist, those scenes will live the way they were exposed. Because back to your question of when we're thinking about the cost of a film, there are moments when I say, what's the right thing to do in this moment? Is it right to think that I'm going to have a colorist who understands how to put a power window on this part of the image and color that so it is in the right dynamic range in the final scene? Or is it best to just expose the entire scene for this image? Is it right to take the time to light this one area of my frame on set and take all the manpower and the time to do that in that moment while everyone's waiting around? Or can I easily color that section of the image in post? And I'm constantly needing to make those calls. If I'm cut out of the process, that final image may be screened somewhere, and I put my head in my hands and I'm looking, going, man, that building is too hot. It's underexposed, or that area of the frame was intended to be more exposed and nobody knows it but me. And so now I make careful notes and logs, but I can't assure that somebody's going to read my notes. So you mm-hmm. never want to cut your DP out of the process. That is one of those areas where that negative or that positive, you know, that image sensor, they understand that inherently, and they understand what they did, and so it's always my goal to stay with a project from start to finish.
Okay. So is color kind of the main area post then that the DPs are involved with?
Color is. Now, I feel very fortunate to have developed some incredible relationships with producers and directors in my career, where very often I will be invited to speak into the edit. Now, it's not my role, you know, it's not my given role, but very often they understand how valuable it is to have my perspective on the shot. And I think my background in music is probably a big reason why I'm naturally drawn to the pace of an edit. I think you learn things like cadence, breathing. What does breathing mean in an edit? When do you hold mm-hmm. on something, and when do you quickly move forward, the pacing of things? So that may be just unique to me. But the other aspect is there have been three films recently where I've been more involved in speaking into the visual effects. And one project in particular that will be coming out here not too long from now, where so much of the film wasn't even filmed on set, but we were expecting it to be created later with visual effects. And so understanding what that will be, the degree, how much of the image is going to be created later and how much of it is acquired at the moment, that's huge. So visual effects is a huge aspect. And then being able to consult in pre-production and in production with that visual effects artist, if possible, is crucial. And to some degree, that was able to happen on that film that I'm referring to.
One other question I have is sometimes, you know, you have to end up doing reshoots or pickup shoots. And so how should a producer work with a DP when it comes to those?
I think one of the most important things for everybody to agree on when you're looking at pickups and reshoots is that they are more difficult than principal photography, because for starters they happen with a delay, right? You shoot the film, very often you have an edit of the film, and then you go back and you reshoot. You are in a different personal rhythm, you're in a different rhythm as a crew. You have to come back to that same mindset, but then you also have to technically be in the same space. And so it's extremely important that you have good notes going into that, that you can match your footage, that you're using the same equipment as much as possible, or equipment that will easily integrate within the material. And then do not shortchange yourself on crew, because it takes extra time, depending on the style of shoot. If you're adding new scenes, it's somewhat easier. But if you are integrating shots into existing scenes, it is extremely difficult. And then getting those performances also to match those moments so that when you go from cut to cut, that it felt like the same thing. Hair, wardrobe, makeup, all of this lighting, all of those things are crucial. And so it is much more difficult to achieve continuity of look in those shots than anyone would possibly imagine. But every DP out there listening to this right now, if there is anyone besides me, is nodding and shaking their head wildly, like, yes. But very often, everything I just said is the exact opposite mindset. Everyone's going, oh, this will be easy. You know, we just go in and get that one shot, or we'll just get those three shots and we got a movie. And nobody is thinking about, like, oh, wait, I forgot to bring that pillow that we need that's in that shot. Oh, I've got a yellow pillow. Will that work? No, it was a white pillow. You know, those are the things that I'm looking at the image and my mental math is going nuts. I'm like, we got to make sure we bring that. And so many of those elements are completely out of my realm of authority and responsibility. Mm-hmm. And so I kind of keep my mouth shut because I'm assuming everybody's, and then I hear, oh, what? We didn't hire an AD for this, for these pickups. Oh, wait, we didn't hire the production designer back. And then everyone looks at me like that it only takes a camera to make those things happen. Like, guys, I can point the camera in the right direction, but if I don't have the same elements to reproduce that, I'm blind. You know, I don't have anything. And so I think it's extremely important with pickups and reshoots that you view them as they are, that you view them as difficult as they possibly are. I'm not saying to make them more difficult than they need to be, but to truly understand their very essence and nature.
So that was where all the questions I had for you. So I don't know if there's any final thoughts that have come that you want to share.
I'm going to put this out there for, I'm not going to make an assumption that what I say just is or is true, but I'm going to speak this is what's true for me as a cinematographer working with a producer. And if this resonates with a producer and has an impact, I think that impact will be one that is very well received by any crew that they ever work with in the future. So there's a moment in the film Braveheart where William Wallace is confronting some of the lords in Scotland, and he basically says, you think that the people exist to provide you with position, but I tell you that your position exists so that you can provide freedom for the people. And it's this idea that, you know, it sounds like it, when I call myself a cinematographer, you know, it means something to me. It means something to my filmmaking friends, and it means something to people who are outsiders to the industry. If I were to call myself a producer, you know, all of us hold our positions with some regard. And some of us hold those positions different. You know, we all hold them different. If I were a producer, I would view myself as the person who holds the intellectual property that is created at the end, holds the rights to that. But the way that I would get to that point is through one simple thing: service. So this is how I've come to this. My working definition as a cinematographer of an incredible producer, somebody who is immensely talented and valuable in what they do and what they are to a movie and what they bring to a movie, is simply this: a person who deeply understands how to bring the right people together to make a project, and to then put those right people in the right positions to make the film, and then does everything within their power and their resource to remove as many obstacles as possible, enabling and empowering those people to do exactly and precisely what they were hired to do. Now, what I've experienced too often is there is a lack of connection between reality and desires. Like, here's what we're setting out to do. We really don't have the budget to do this, but we're going to do it anyway. So we're going to do it at the cost of the people making the film. We're going to take our problem that we've created and put it on you. Think about filmmaking. Filmmaking is literally a bunch of creatives and technical folks sitting around creating problems that they then have to solve. I mean, think about it. We create our own problems to solve. But what you don't want to do is add unnecessary problems to that. Oh, you guys need to solve all those problems that are necessary to create this film, but now you've got to do it in 18-hour days instead of 10-hour days or 12-hour days, because we can only afford to film this many days. So we're still going to do the same thing, but we're going to do it at your cost. So ideally, producers are never, an incredible producer will always look at the problems they're facing and they'll figure out where to build the dam and not let those problems go through. They're going to hold within themselves problems, because if I'm paying money as a producer to hire a cinematographer to do their job, the last thing I need them doing is solving makeup problems or solving production design problems or solving personnel problems or solving equipment problems. I want them solving the problems that relate to their role. The last thing I need to do is put extra problems on them. If I am paying money to hire a director, I don't want them solving scheduling issues, right? And so you want to make sure that you're not putting, be honest with yourself again about the film you're making, and make the film that you have the budget for. And very often, maybe consider, is this the right time to make that movie? Or should I wait till I have the budget to make the movie that I'm setting out to make?
I really like that. I think it applies really well to producers. And yeah, thank you very much for being a part of the show.
Absolutely.
Until next time, make sure to subscribe to the Producer Podcast. And thanks for listening. I'm your host, Micah Versman, and this is the Producer Podcast. Today, we are continuing our department head series as we talk with DP Dan Parsons about what a producer should know about the camera department. So without further ado, let's get started.